In the video on E2 reactions, I showed you how a strong base, and all of this happens simultaneously, a strong base can nab a hydrogen off of this carbon right here. And it's just nabbing the proton itself. It's not grabbing the hydrogen and the electron. And then that electron goes to this carbon right over there. And then that allows that carbon to give away the electron that was forming a bond with the chlorine to go with the chlorine. This all happened at once. The chloride got eliminated. Now, one thing that might pop out in your brain is, why did I pick this hydrogen? Why did I pick the hydrogen right over here? Why couldn't I have picked that hydrogen over there? And I'm going to introduce you a little bit of terminology, and then I'll introduce you to a rule. And then I'll tell you a little bit about why people think this rule works. So in general, the carbon that has the functional group on it, that's the alpha carbon. So let me label it. This carbon right here is the alpha carbon. And in order to have an E2 reaction, in this case when we did the video on E2 reactions, but actually the rule will hold as well for E1 reactions. But in order to have the E2 reaction, the hydrogen has to get swiped off of a beta carbon. And a beta carbon is just a carbon that's one away from the alpha carbon. So this is a beta carbon, and this is also a beta carbon. And so it's completely reasonable, one would think, that, well, it could swipe it from there, or it could swipe it from there. And let's think about this reaction. Let's just draw it out so you could visualize it a little bit better. So here we swiped it from this beta carbon. Let me redraw the reaction where we're swiping it from the other beta carbon. So I want both reactions on the screen at the same time. So let me draw our methoxide. So we have our oxygen bonded to a CH3 to a methyl group. The oxygen has 7 valence electrons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I'll do the 7th one, the one that will bond with the hydrogen. I'll do it in green. And instead of attacking that hydrogen, or taking that proton, I should say, because it's not taking the electron with it, it does it to this one. So what it does is it takes this proton, or it bonds with that hydrogen proton, and then the hydrogen protons, or that hydrogen's electron, can then be taken by this molecule. So then it goes to the alpha carbon to form a double bond between this beta carbon and the alpha carbon. And so now this alpha carbon got that electron, doesn't need the electron that's bonded with the chloro group anymore. And so that goes to the chlorine to form chloride. Chlorine was already way more electronegative. It was already hogging it. Now it gets to go there. And now when all is said and done, our products look like this. We still have the methanol, just like we had in the original reaction, because this grabbed this hydrogen. Let me draw it. So you have your OCH3. And let me draw all of this. So you have that pair right over there. You have this pair right over here. And then you have this purple electron. And now it's bonded with this green electron, which is now on the hydrogen. So it is now bonded with this green electron that has been given to the hydrogen. Oh, and not to make sure we don't forget it, this oxygen over here had 7 valence electrons. So it had a negative charge. Neutral oxygen would have 6. So this had a negative charge. But now that it gave its electron to this hydrogen, it now has a neutral charge and is now methanol, exactly what we saw when we first learned about E1 reactions. We also know that the chloro group, it took that electron. It's now a chloride anion. So let me draw that. And that's exactly the same as what we in the first video on E1 reactions. So it's now a chloride anion. It has grabbed this orange electron. It has grabbed the orange electron. Let me do it in orange. It has grabbed this orange electron. So it now has a negative charge. You can imagine that the negative charge has been transferred from the methoxide to the chloride anion. And now what's different this time is that the double bond is now between the 1 and the 2 carbon, and not between the 2 and the 3 carbon. So now it's going to look like this. So now the result, this product, if the reaction went this way, would look like this. We have this carbon right here. It is bonded to 2 hydrogens. It is bonded to 2 hydrogens. Now it has a double bond with this carbon. It has a double bond. And I'll do the second bond. I'll do the pi bond of the double bond in purple. right over there. I'll assume that that's the pi bond. That's the new double bond formed. And now this carbon, let me do, which was the alpha carbon, is right over here. This was the alpha carbon. It's bonded to one hydrogen. And then let me draw everything else. So then you have a carbon. This guy is bonded to three hydrogens. I could have just written a CH3 if I wanted. This guy is bonded to two hydrogens. And we're done. And so instead of, as we saw in the first video on E2 reactions, instead of forming butene, we now have it still 1, 2, 3, 4 carbons, so still bute. But the double bond is on the one carbon, right? We'd start 1, 2, 3, 4. So we could call this bute-1-ene or 1-butene either way. So let's call this bute-1-ene. So the question is, which is more likely to happen? Do both happen? Does, you know, or does one happen disproportionately? And the answer is that yes, one happens disproportionately. This one. This is the dominant product. If you were to perform this reaction, this is what, and you were to analyze in your beaker, wherever you're performing the reaction, what you see most of, the majority product, the great majority, is going to be the bute-2-ene, not the bute-1-ene. Maybe you see very, very little of this. And the question is why, or how would you even be able to determine that, or how could you have predicted that? And to predict it, there's something called Zaitsev's rule, and I'm sure I'm mispronouncing it, but let me write it down. So Zaitsev's rule, and it's kind of analogous to Markovnikov's rule, but for elimination reactions. If you think about it, the addition reactions that we did many videos ago are the opposite of the elimination reactions. The addition reactions were adding the chloro group, and the elimination were taking it off. And so Zaitsev's rule is kind of analogous to Markovnikov's rule. Now, first I'll just tell you the rule, and then we can think a little bit about why it works. And you know, the jury's not out on this. People are they think they know why it works, but they're not 100% sure. So Zaitsev's rule says the carbon that is going to lose the hydrogen is the one that has fewer hydrogens. So let me write it down over here. Carbon more likely to lose hydrogen is, I should say the hydrogen proton, because it keeps the electron still, is the one with fewer hydrogens. So if you were to look at this reaction right here, we have our alpha carbon. Either this beta carbon or this beta carbon could lose its hydrogen. This one has three hydrogens on it. This one only has two. So Zaitsev's rule tells us that this is the hydrogen, or actually the proton, that is more likely to be reacted with the base. You could almost view it as it is the more acidic proton. It is a lower hanging fruit for this strong base to capture. Now, a more interesting question, that's a pretty easy rule to follow. And if they both had the same number, then you'd see equal products depending on which side it gets. Now, the question is, why is this happening? And here, something called hyperconjugation comes into effect. Hyperconjugation. I'm not going to go into details in it, into the quantum mechanics of it. Hyperconjugation. And hyperconjugation is the notion that the fact, so we said that the one with the fewer hydrogens is the one that's less likely to lose, or the one that with fewer hydrogens is the one more likely to lose the hydrogen proton. But the one with fewer hydrogens is also bonded to more carbons. This guy is bonded to one carbon. This outside of the alpha carbon, he's actually bonded to two, the alpha and this carbon. This guy right here is only bonded to the alpha carbon. And hyperconjugation is the notion that not the beta carbon, but the carbons one over from that help stabilize the double bond that eventually forms. I almost think of it, you have more electrons over here, because carbons have more electrons to offer than hydrogens. So you kind of have, at the end of the day, this guy is more likely able to donate electrons to form from the right-hand side to make a double bond than from the left-hand side. I won't go into the detail of hyperconjugation, but it's all based on the notion that the more stable double bond will be formed if we have other carbons near the double bond. And another way to think about it is to look at the products. So we saw, or Zaitsev's rule tells us, that bute-2-ene is a more likely product than bute-1-ene. And if you look at bute-1-ene, we could rewrite it like this. We could draw the double bond like this. this carbon is what was the alpha carbon. We could draw a carbon right here. And then it is bonded to a hydrogen. It's bonded to this hydrogen. And then it's bonded to just a chain of carbons. And we'll just write R that. And then this guy is just bonded to two hydrogens. So this is bute. This isn't necessarily bute-1-ene. I just put an R here, but this is how it could be represented. Now the bute-2-ene, if we wanted to draw it like this, would look like this. If we wanted to call, we could call this right here. We could call this R prime. It's just a chain of carbons. And then we could call this. And then we could call this R prime prime. It's another, it's not even a chain, it's just one carbon. But if we call it that, then the bute-2-ene, let me draw it down here where I have more real estate. The bute-2-ene would look like this. You have your carbon-carbon double bond. Carbon-carbon double bond. Now the left-hand carbon is bonded to a hydrogen, that hydrogen right there, and to R prime. And the right-hand carbon is bonded to a hydrogen and R prime prime. So it's bonded to a hydrogen and R prime prime. All I did here, let me see if I can fit it all on the same screen, is I just redrew this and I just abstracted away the chain as it goes away from the double bond. And I did that so that we can look at it this way. We can just have the double bond kind of as our focus of attention and think about what's going on around it. Over here, for the bute-1-ene, and we already said this is the lesser product, so this is the greater product. This is the greater, the dominant product. In the lesser product, we only have, if we go off of the double pair, double bond, we only have one alkyl group right there, that R right here. Over here, we have two. And we say that this is more substituted. And when we say substituted, you're imagining that you're substituting hydrogens with carbon chains, with alkyl groups. So this one right here is more substituted. And hyperconjugation, so the idea would have it, is that these carbon chains that are near the double bond help stabilize it. They're able to kind of, some of their sigma electrons and sigma orbitals are there to somehow help stabilize the pi orbitals. And now this is getting into quantum mechanics and all of that, so it's a little bit, and it's, you know, the world isn't 100% clear whether that's definitely the mechanism, although people have run the experiment, and they know that the more substituted product is what you're going to see more of, as opposed to the less substituted. And then that all comes from Zaitsev's rule. So hopefully, you at least get Zaitsev's rule. The hyperconjugation, that's kind of a deeper concept, and it's, you know, the jury's not even out on it. That's a belief of why Zaitsev's rule works, but the rule itself is pretty straightforward. If you're trying to pick between two beta carbons, the one that's going to lose the hydrogen is the one that already has fewer hydrogens, or the one that's bonded to more carbons. And this is true, I drew it, everything we focused on right now was in an E2 reaction, but it's just as true in an E1 reaction.